Okay, thank you for your patience. We had an executive session. There are no items that we require a vote following executive session. Item 3, adopt current rules and procedures to accept new changes of the new council members and reflect new committee appointments. Once again, I'd like to welcome new member Justin Bradley, new member Mr. Bob Walker. Mr. Walker, having folks on board today. You will find in your agenda packet the reflection of the new committees. Anything else we need to do, Lisa, other than announce the new committee that's been appointed? Don't think so? Okay. Item 4, selection of a vice chair.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to waive rules and nominate elect Jane Hall as vice chair.
I'll second that. A motion and a second on Jane Hall. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your hand. All opposed, I vote affirmative, and it passes. Thank you, Jane.
Mr. Chairman, I'm sorry. Can we go back to item number 2 and have a special vote?
Number what?
On item number 3.
3? Yeah, what you need? What you want us to do?
You've got to adopt it.
Adopt it?
Adopt rules.
The rules and procedures. So the new changes. We have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, I vote affirmative, and it passes. Thank you. That take care of that, please?
Yes.
Okay. Jane, congratulations.
Thank you. I appreciate the honor.
Next, we have 5 appointments of 3 members to Appalachian Council of Government Board. We have Jane, which, Jane, you are the current chair?
I am.
Of the board, so congratulations on that role. We need 2 more members to serve on COP. So, I don't know what discussions have taken place.
I've been in discussion with Roger. I think Roger would be a great asset to the COP board. Michael had mentioned it, but I really don't know.
You have to be present to win.
That's right. That means once a month. Bob, you or Justin want to do it?
Or lose.
At Mason Greenville?
Yeah, I'm willing. Yeah, absolutely.
Mr. Chairman, I will nominate Jane Hall, Roger Nutt, and Justin Bradley to serve on the
All right, we have a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
Second. All right. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, I vote affirmative. And it passes. And again, congratulations to a very important board. Item 6, appointment of council members to SPATS, Area Transportation, automatically by virtue of Public Works Chairman. Mr. Nutt's on the board, and I am as chairman. So we need 1 more person to serve on the SPATS.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to nominate Justin Bradley.
I'll second that.
A motion and a second on Mr. Bradley. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, vote affirmative. And it passes. Thank you. Another very important committee. Next, we receive information on Accommodations Tax Advisory Committee. We need to get some bios going for that committee. Board of Appeals, we had 1 resign. We need to fill that seat. It is a real estate person that we need. We need someone that has to be School District 3.
Yes.
School District 3 and a real estate person. Let's move forward.
I think we got that taken care of.
All right. Cleveland County Board of Appeals, we had 1 want to be reappointed. We had 1 that did not want to be reappointed. We had a bio on Billy Sample.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to hold off on that appointment until next month if possible.
Well, we have 1 individual council member that wants to hold this appointment over. What say ye?
I would like to waive the rules and nominate Billy Samples for that position.
Is it 2 positions or 1 open, Deb? It's 2 positions open. Okay.
Okay, I'll second Mr. Samples.
All right, we've got a motion and a second on Billy Samples.
And that's for the Fire Chiefs Association?
Yes.
Okay.
Any other discussion?
Point question.
Yes, sir.
Why do we need a motion to waive the rules?
That's just way it is.
I think on what you just passed, yeah. You don't waive the rules anymore.
It's
am I wrong or right?
I think the rules of appointments are
says in there waive rules. It says waive rules and nominate.
Does anybody have the rules about nominate, the nomination process and all that, or we can? Take a lot of knowledge from the nomination process, I think, for nominating.
Oh, no, I'm not saying nominate two people. My question is.
Anyway, let someone just read the current rule we have.
Well, that's under the local rules under 10-2 for the election process. At the meeting at which the election is to be held, the chairman shall announce the names of all nominees of vacancies. Should the number of the nominees exceed the number of vacancies, each member of the council shall vote for a number of nominees equal to the number of the vacancies to be filled. The vacancies shall be filled by these nominees receiving the largest number of votes. Thus, if there's one, should be one vacancy, it shall be filled by the nominee receiving the highest number of votes. If there are two vacancies, they shall be filled by the nominees receiving the first and the second highest number of votes, and so forth, as the case may be. In addition, there's 10.1 that talks about the election and appointment and then pending vacancies. At a regular meeting of the council held at least 1 month prior to the expiration of the terms of any boards or commissions whose successors are to be elected by the council, county administrator shall place upon the agenda the names of the impending vacancies. At the meeting, the chairperson shall give the notice of such elections, shall announce at the next meeting of the council nomination to fill such vacancies will be entertained by the chair. And then at the next meeting, council preceding the meeting in which the election is to be held is where they present the nominations and the biographical sketches.
So actually, it is a time-consuming procedure if we go by the rules. That's why we therefore waive the rules to go ahead and nominate and elect.
Okay. That answers your question, Mr. Walker.
It answered my question. I don't understand what we're doing, so I'll say that. I'll just work that.
Let me ask that. Yes, Chairman, ask a question. What is the procedure if you do not want to waive the rules? What's the objection procedure if somebody wanted to object to waiving the rules to nominate somebody?
With respect to waiving the rules, you would have to have a majority vote to waive the rules.
Okay. Well.
He's asking if we didn't waive rules, how long would it take?
Well, I'm asking if somebody wanted to object to waiving the rules for an appointment, they would have to have four people vote against the nomination, basically.
What we ought to do,
is
rewrite those rules and change them.
Of course.
Then we could take that out if we waive the rules. That'd be the thing to do.
We don't have anything else to do.
That's right.
I think that there are two times I've noticed that you regularly waive the rules. One is under your board's official appointments, and the other is on resolutions that you do. If you'd like, we can take a look at those two areas of your procedures and bring back what you typically have become accustomed to doing and why you're waiving the rules, and perhaps make it more to what you're more accustomed to doing.
It's just fun to say.
Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, vote affirmative. Passes for Billy Sutton. Crosshanger Fire.
We're having problems just getting people to sign pieces of paper, but as soon as we get all that in order, we'll be able to do that, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. Unless the bow is for it. No bow yet, Debbie?
Yes, sir.
Downtown Advisory, Airport Advisory Board.
I'd like to waive the rules and nominate and elect Dean Garrison.
Second. I have a motion and a second on Mr. Garrison. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your hand. All opposed, vote affirmative, and it passes. Employee agreements. We need to fill that spot. Henry Fire.
Once again, as soon as we get the paperwork.
Health Services Board.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to waive rules, nominate Blake Wilson Smith.
Second.
Motion and second on Wilson P. Smith. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. Opposed, vote affirmative, passes. Hobbiesville, Fire District. Lakewood Hills Special Tax. That Bob? Bob, is that you, Lakewood Hills?
I don't.
Was that Dale's? Yeah, that's Dale's. Have you been on, coming to discuss that with staff?
I will.
Yeah.
I have no idea.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. FEMA Community.
Mr. Chairman, I just have a point of questioning, I suppose, on the FEMA Community Actions Board of Trustees. Can we table any nominations until their legal problems are taken care of, or what do we do with that?
Table, you can't bring it up for a while. We just carry it over?
Well, the ones that they're going to continue to serve until they're replaced, right?
Right, and my understanding is I don't think that they've received any kind of bios request and reappointment of those individuals, so we would just carry them over.
Just carry them over.
Practice.
Okay.
Does that answer your question, Jane?
It does.
For the time being?
Thank you.
Okay. And our Twin Lakes, Bob, this is another, this is Roger's, not yours, but it's similar, so maybe Roger can give you some advice on this as well as you move forward. Twin Lakes Special Tax District.
All five of these have agreed to serve, but they have not agreed to give me any paperwork.
But anyway, sir. Unifire, we have three, but no bios here. Okay. All right, so when you get some bios on these, and Davis will have Bob with Lakewood Hills explain what that is about, and Roger will be able to do the same. Okay, that concludes that part of the meeting. Now we will move to our committees, and the first committee is Economic Recruitment and Development. I'm the Baby Britt Chairman, Michael Brown, Roger Nutt, members. Mr. Britt?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Item A, can I entertain a motion to strike this matter from the agenda in consideration by the committee since the matter was inadvertently placed on the agenda in a scrivener's error?
I so move, Mr. Chairman.
I'll second that. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. We'll recommend full council to remove it. Actually, it won't even come up since we removed it. Item B, do I hear a motion to approve amendment of an agreement for development of a joint county industrial business park between Spartanburg and Cherokee County for Cherokee's project New Idea?
So moved.
Motion made. I'll second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. We'll recommend full council at 5:30. Last item, do I hear a motion to approve and authorize County Administrator Catherine O'Neill to execute the agreement regarding a sewer infrastructure improvement agreement with Spartanburg Sanitary Sewer District?
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries, and recommend that full council at 5:30. Mr. Chairman, that concludes our committee meeting.
Thank you, Mr. Britt. No items today on public health, Justin. We do have a committee. Justin Bradley's chairman, Michael Brown, Bob Walker, members. Personnel Finance, Honorable Bob Walker, Chairman Jeff Court, and Jane Hall, members. Mr. Walker?
My name is Jeff, the other guys, sometimes. Learn the process here. But item A is to receive information and take the desired action in reference to unfreezing Spartanburg Area Transportation System positions. And I know Mr. Bob Hartslager is here. He's ready to present to us his recommendation.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good afternoon. I'm here this afternoon to ask that you give consideration to unfreezing two positions in our department and reclassifying one of those. I provided you a memorandum which outlines the reason for doing this now. It also outlines the way it would pay for it. I think that most of that is pretty self-explanatory, but certainly I'd be happy to answer any questions. And a lot of ways, we're on the front lines of a lot of what you talked about earlier in your strategic planning session today. We continue to see growth and this is our attempt to try to get out in front of that and really to deal with it in an effective way that provides good effective service. So, once again, I think I tried to outline in the memo, once again, both the reason as to why we're asking now, how we would pay for it. SPAS would cover the vast majority of these funds at the minimum impact on the general fund. And also, really, through increased revenues for permitting, we've been able to identify how we cover the max. So I think that we've got that part firmly covered.
So you're seeing a lot more increase in need to do this and bringing in more money through these processes?
Well, I think Ms. Hall, as I outlined in my memo, and I gave you one metric, which was just walking traffic since 2011. There's certainly other metrics that we could identify, but it's all up in terms of the folks that we see in our office and what we're being asked to do. And I'm very keenly aware that's the case all across the county, so I'm here to speak for planning. But once again, we're on the front end of something. We're trying to be proactive, implement a number of things, and I think it's going to be pretty essential for us to get some help when we do that.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to move that we accept the position request by Mr. Hartman.
I'll second. Catherine, could you give us just a two-minute excerpt about what's going on in the public room? I don't know what we're talking about here because it came to us. And maybe give us a two-minute view or Bobby, one on what we're doing here.
Sure. I think that the growth that we're seeing in the county is resulting in additional permits, both in the building code and in planning. And planning froze two positions in their SPACS program that were planning positions while we were going through an economic downturn. If you take a look at the second page of the memo that was provided to you, you'll see that our walk-in traffic since 2011 has increased by almost 50%. So while we were seeing roughly 1,700 customers in 2011, we've surpassed 2,500 customers in a year now in 2014. And I think based on some of the projections that we're seeing, that trend is gonna continue to go up. So in order for us to tackle area performance planning and make sure that we're providing good customer service, Bob needs to unfreeze these positions. So these have been positions we've used before for county planning. This offers him a chance to take advantage of additional revenues with SPACs and additional permitting revenue to fill these two positions.
Okay. Kathy, can you give me the numbers for active positions back in 2006? Roughly versus what active positions we have now?
Can do it before this comes out of committee later on this afternoon. I don't have that information.
Okay, yeah, I think you did that before
this afternoon. Before, all right.
It was before this time.
So you're looking for the number of positions in SPAS specifically in 2006 and the number now?
In planning.
In planning.
Bob, you can probably round that up, can't you?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Sir. You can probably round that up for the committee meeting.
I'm assuming, Mr. Chairman, that we can.
So, okay.
We'll do our best, so I guess.
Okay.
I was not here either, so.
Right.
How long is these two positions? They've been frozen for a number of years, I think, right?
They have been, Mr. Chairman. Since I've been here, I know that we've traded frozen positions in planning just to try to do the best we could. So, this has been a direct result. When I came here, Councilman Walker, in 2012, we were down 100 positions countywide, and I know that the positions we're talking about were some of those positions then.
All right. Any other questions? Got a motion? Do I have a second?
Second.
All those in favor of the committee, raise your hand. All right.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. All right. receive information and take desired action in reference to a request from the assessor's office to reclassify a property data technician position, grade 43, to senior property data technician position, grade 45.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman, council members. I come before you today to request a reclassification of a position within my office. I respectfully request to reclassify a property data technician position, grade 43, to a senior property data technician position, which is a grade 45, to correct an inequity in my department. The reclassification represents an annual salary increase of $2,974, and it has a current fiscal year budget impact of $1,357. This reclassification would be budget neutral and would not increase the bottom line of my current fiscal year budget because of after a recent departure or transfer of an employee, senior employee, to the GIS department. The inequity in my department is a result of two employees performing the same duties, but one is a grade higher than the other. One is a senior property data tech, and the other one is just a property data technician. And so this would correct that inequity, and both employees would be the same grade. I provided you with a memo. I could go into more detail with that. The position that we're talking about predominantly handles in our legal resident special assessment applications. As a result of several acts by the South Carolina Legislature, Act 38 of 2006, Act 179 of 2012, and Act 76 of 2009, the legal residence has become more valuable and more complicated to process. And so we had to change the procedures in my department to facilitate those applications. We have instituted a new application process. We've instituted auditing. We've instituted more documentation to ensure that those people who qualify for the special assessment are the only ones that receive that special assessment. All right.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we approve the reclassification request.
We have a motion to approve the reclassification. Got a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed? Aye. Thank you.
Thank you.
And next is a request for information to take desired action in reference to a request from the Sheriff's Office to reclassify administrative position. Says Sheriff Wright. Go ahead.
Thank you, Chair. Council, what we want to do is request a reclassification of one of our administrative secretaries. We transferred her over to our narcotics office several years ago, and she has taken on a tremendous responsibility over there with case files and forfeitures and things like that. And we want to increase or reclassify it to a grade 45, which is an administrative assistant position. I believe what Kelly Newman tells us, it would increase our budget $800, but based on the next item on the agenda, we would reduce all that and it would be cut in our budget.
Could you tell me one thing I'm learning? AFIS.
That's an automated fingerprint imaging system, right, or identification system.
All right, so that's something within your office.
Yes, sir.
All right. Thank you. Any other questions? Do I have a motion?
Motion to approve.
Motion to approve. Do I have a second?
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no. Pass. All right. Man. Receive information, take desired action in reference to convert a sworn position to a civilian position. And Sheriff Department, who's it? All right. Mark?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. This is a... What we want to do is reclassify a master deputy position, turn it into a civilian position, and it would become a senior administrative assistant position. It's one of those details of the sheriff's office where a civilian with the proper training can handle this responsibility. We do have somebody in mind who is currently doing this at another agency, and that's what we're trying to achieve. If a master deputy position being transferred into a senior administrative position, our budget approximately 70,000. should be under budget on both of these items.
The sworn position is a meet certain.
A certified liquor officer, yes, sir. And normally that's, prior to this, we had two certified law enforcement officers working on our AFIS. One retired, and we have not filled that position yet.
Now, it's my understanding that you don't have to be certified in law enforcement in order to do this position.
No, you can take a civilian and train them with proper techniques.
From what I understand from the information you gave us, there's several departments across this state that utilize the civilians we're doing.
We Chad Sled actually uses civilians, as Greenville County does also. Any questions?
Any other questions?
Motion to approve the request.
We have a motion to approve the request. Do I have a second?
Second.
So all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed?
Thank you.
All right, thank you. Receive information and take desired action in reference to a request from the clerk of court's office to reclassify senior accountant part-time position to a full-time position and to change the title to senior court clerk. The Honorable Hope Blackley.
Thank you. Good afternoon. I stand before you in regards to this position, and it's more of an effort to clean up. Because of the caseloads and the balance from our common plea or civil division and the clerk of court's office, we've had an increased workload. And this position was in, this person who has this position was in this position before I took office. And she has been staying over, working over on a regular basis because she can't keep up with getting her work completed. And so she asked if she could come back full time. I'm not sure why she didn't know why her job title was a senior account clerk. She has been performing the duties of a senior court clerk since she's been here, which I think she's been in this position since the 1973. So I'm not sure why she was in a senior account clerk's position. But to make it correct and clean it up, it needs to be a senior court clerk, which is actually a great lower than the senior account clerk. But this is more of a cosmetic thing and try to have the ability to make sure that we're processing and moving forward with our paperwork. So I ask for your consideration on this change.
Okay, this is just a title change. There's no monies?
It's a lower paying job, but she's going
to... part-time to full-time.
Right.
Oh, okay. Yes. I got you. I move to approve this reclassification.
Second. Motion second. Approve the request. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay. All right. Thank you. All right. Receive information, take desired action in reference to a request. Former Gauntlet Drug Abuse Commission, reclassify slot 8039, grade 45, position code 1045 from accountant technician to chief administrative assistant, grade 82, and to unfreeze slot 83, SADAC deputy director, position code grade 85, and freeze senior program coordinator, grade 84, Sue LeBron.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and welcome to your position and you as well, Mr. Bradley, on the County Council. I look forward to working with you. This basically comes as a continued result of my assessment and realignment of services at SADAC. What I have done, one of the things that I needed to do was to move a program from treatment to criminal justice. So that had an effect where the front desk really was not operating at full efficiency. And with the approval of the assessment team, it's been a great success. We've increased our numbers of assessments, and we are now turning away zero folks when they come in for their assessments. When, if you recall, when I came to several months ago, it was in the neighborhood of, you know, 9 to 12, as much as 15 or more per week. So because of that increase of services, our front desk needs some additional supervision. So that is the request to promote our the billing position, the account a position to the senior chief administrative assistant. She will not be, we will not be replacing her position. She will be maintaining the work in that position and working with the front desk staff to be sure that that work is occurring. And it just makes a sense from Flawless. The client comes in, they sign in, they do their paperwork, they do their insurance work, and it's all handled in a seamless, efficient way. This program, the front desk then, will then be moving under our current senior program coordinator for finance. And over the last many, many years, our senior program coordinator for finance has taken on additional duties. And I know my predecessor has requested promotion for her to deputy director. With her now taking on this added oversight, I'm recommending that she be promoted to deputy director as well. That answers the question. So if you have any other questions, I'll be happy to answer them.
No, I'm just really impressed with the work that you've been doing, Sue. I think you are bringing up to another level SADAC, and it's been a much needed thing. I thank you for your effort and all that you're doing. And you have a great staff there. They need to be recognized for that. Thank you. I, at this time, make a motion to approve this request.
Second. Motion and second to approve. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no.
Thank you, Dan. Have a nice evening.
Thank you, ma'am. And you also had in your packet the updated financial data and personal basis, the personal basis.
Fine. Keep Sue and her team from having to come out at 5:30. No, you don't have a problem with me.
No, I don't have a problem.
So, can you mention?
Yeah. I would not have that.
Just tell her she can not have to.
All right. All right,
I've told her, so you know, Ms. Chair, needs to come back next tomorrow.
They're instructing me what I need
to go through this with us again. We'd love to have it.
Thank you very much.
Righty.
Mr. Chairman, you did have a number of department heads, including Sue, who presented to you. If you don't need any of the department heads to come back based on the remainder of council, I'd like to give them that opportunity to not say for the main meeting.
Oh, that's fine. Yeah, I support. I don't see a reason.
Not that we don't want to have you around.
Yeah, that's right. All right, that's all.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Walker. Next, we have livability. Honorable Jane Hall, Chairman, David Britt, Michael Brown, member. Ms. Hall?
Yes, we're going to receive information and take desired action in reference to a request from the Parks Department to apply for a grant from the Spartanburg County Foundation. And Jim Campbell is here to present.
Yes, thank you. As y'all might know, we currently operate during the summer two different programs. One is a summer playground program, and one is a summer camp program. Of the two, the summer camp program is the higher quality of the two. What we are intending to do this year, assuming y'all pass the operating budget, is to de-emphasize the playground program and expand the park or the summer camp program. We've secured a fourth site. We operated three last year. We operated four this year. And what this money would be for is that we are going to endeavor to subsidize for low-income children the participation in the summer camp program, which is a fee-based program. And so we had already programmed in a level of subsidy in our financial projections and decided to apply for this grant, if y'all approve, so that we could expand the number of kids who we could give a subsidy to and thus more kids participate in the program.
What are the names of the sites that you're going to be using?
I'll call on Ms. Elizabeth here.
Inman Elementary, Kids Quest is partnership. We're still trying to work out all the details. Upstate Family Resource Center and Woodruff Leisure Center will be our four throughout the county.
Upstate what?
Resource Center.
Where is that?
It's in Long Springs? Yes.
And where was the Inman was what?
Inman Elementary.
And then you had a one in between those?
Yes, ma'am. It's Kids Quest Learning Center.
Where is that?
It's actually right behind our office on Fair Forest Road. Oh. It's out of the Evangel cathedral building.
Okay.
And we're still working out the parks partnership agreement with them.
So this grant application would give you the ability to create monies for these children who had been in these other programs, but now could move up to the more advanced programs as far as activities for them.
That's right. We're trying to give a better quality program and reach out to more kids.
Do I have a motion for that?
So moved.
Second.
Motion in a second. Any comments? Okay, all those in favor, raise a hand. Thank you. That's approved. We'll send it to the 5:30 meeting. Okay, we also have Jim here to receive information and take desired action in reference to the Parks Enhancement Plan.
Thank you all. This is going to be kind of exciting for me at least because I've devoted a substantial portion of my work life to this since I've been here. Before I get into it, I want to call your attention to the last line on the screen. This came to me as if in a dream. Trying to define what it is that the Parks Department is doing holistically. And I think this is what we're doing. We're partnering with people to promote community wellness. And I just wanted to throw that out for y'all's input, if you have any now or later, because when you come right down to it, everything we are doing is either promoting the community's physical health or physical health. And we're doing it through partnership. So if you have any thoughts about that, it's not set in stone. I'd just like to offer it up here. Many of you know I like quotes, and I think this is a good one from the standpoint of planning. Thinking well to be wise, planning well wiser, doing well wisest and best of all. Good guy to quote from. And hopefully this is what you'll be hearing in the next few minutes. We're going to talk about the methodology for the Parks Enhancement Plan. Those of you who were not privy to this, by virtue of your not being on council, I thought this would be helpful. We'll show you the status, and bottom line, what we're requesting is that you just receive this report as and you use it as a planning tool as you go forward in the budget process over the next 2 or 3 months. In the beginning, what we did was to identify that we had a number of parks operations and maintenance issues, particularly at our older parks. And in FY12, we had appropriated funding for a park condition assessment to try to identify what those issues were. What we were trying to do is to come up with some recommendations to y'all for the setting of policies. What I wanted to do, this is out of my past history, is to avoid a traditional facilities plan. In those you survey people as to their needs and desires and compare to national standards, and I found they're not real helpful because basically what comes out of them is I want everything and I want somebody else to pay for it. What we wanted to do was to try to have a practical, physically sustainable approach because we had constrained resources. So it boiled down to 4 things. Fix what's broken, build out existing parks to maximize opportunities, develop partnerships to expand facility availability, and don't build anything you can't maintain. We spent our first year almost in what I call listening and strategizing. We hired a firm to assess the park issues, and they gave us a voluminous report, and then we listened to people. We didn't do a traditional citizen survey, but we listened to people who know things about the community, like county council members, mayors and city administrators, school superintendents, agencies and organizations that I call the natural partners of a parks department, youth athletic association leaders, and in one case we had community meetings in relation to Holston Creek Park. Then we spent about 3 months what I'll call writing and refining. We described the scope, estimated the cost, and the funding mechanism for the projects. And we defined something that I call a construction management methodology that helps us work through the decision process of what gets done and how much it costs. It starts out with a proposal, and then we have request for council approval of the proposal or even preliminary funding in a capital improvement program. We select a designer. We get stakeholder input. We get a preliminary plan, and we bring that to council for y'all's approval. Then we ask for the bids to get construction documents developed. And if needed, during the construction document process, we might find things that cost more than we thought they would. So then we have to either come back to council to revise the funding or to revise the scope of the project to fit funding. Then we select the contractor, like right now, I think in a week's time, right? We'll be receiving bids on Holston Creek Park construction. We go into construction, and if anybody's ever renovated a house, you know, you find things you don't expect. So that's solved by value engineering. You solve problems with the contractor, and you go through the process to get change orders. We get to substantial completion, and we open the project to the public. This is the process that we're going to try to follow, but it will be written into our procedures manual. And then we also propose in the Parks Enhancement Plan policy guidance to guide our decision making. We came up with 10 statements that we recommended to council. Some of them are common sense, but again, we wanted those on the record. We want parks to be safe, attractive, and family friendly. Why do you do park investment? Well, three good reasons: community's quality of life, encouraging neighborhood redevelopment, and tax base expansion. We wanted to provide access, better access to Spartanburg rivers and lakes. We wanted to promote the development of youth sports tourism. We wanted to do trail development, but focus it on in-park walking trails and connecting recreation access or recreation centers to neighborhoods and centers of activity. We wanted our parks to be multi-purpose. We don't really have that many parks in Spartanburg County that are owned by the county. We felt that they should appeal to multiple kinds of people and multiple abilities. We wanted them to be designed and sized so that we could provide a high quality of maintenance. If you don't provide a high quality of maintenance, you buy problems. We wanted to recognize that the membership in the Parks and Recreation Special Tax District should be a precondition for Spartanburg County investment in those municipalities where some parks are located. We also wanted to facilitate and support the efforts of private groups, and of course we wanted to partner with other public and private agencies. In 2012, when y'all passed the resolution adopting the Parks Enhancement Plan, it had the citizen that once every 2 years, we would review it with you to make sure it's in alignment with community needs and the council priorities. Well, now we're in the stage of what I call getting her done. And you'll see a more complete explanation of this list here. But you will notice that almost everything that was in our list in the Parks Enhancement Plan is either underway or it's done. The exception are the five that are listed at the bottom of the list here, which are being proposed in the FY16 CIP, and y'all will take that up later. So our request is that you receive the status report and use it as a planning tool for the upcoming budget process. I'd be happy to try to answer any questions.
I was impressed with how in-depth you went with this Parks Enhancement Plan. It really puts into perspective what you have done, what is being done, and what is yet to be done. And thank you for that. I'd like to see if I can get a motion to receive the Parks Enhancements Plan update as a planning tool to assist in the upcoming budget process.
So moved. Second.
A motion and a second. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. We'll send this to full council. Thank you.
Jay, again, something from the others. Keep those questions down and come back.
Right. Unless anyone has a reason for the park staff to stay, you may be excused. Okay. Right. Thank you. And that's all that I have, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Ms. Hall. Next, we have Public Safety and Judiciary, Honorable Michael Brown, Chairman, Roger Nutt, Bob Walker, Member. Mr. Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We have four items coming before the committee. The first, which is to receive information and take desired action with reference to a resolution ratifying a mutual aid agreement between the Spartanburg County Sheriff's Office and the Sheriff's Office of Danbury County. Major Dillard, please present the information.
Good afternoon, Mr. Brown, committee members. I come to you today to ask you to grant permission that Mrs. Catherine O'Neill be authorized to sign a mutual aid agreement with the Horry County Sheriff's Office. They have asked us for assistance for a special operation which will occur from May 21st to May 25th of this year. We have been asked to provide two jail transport vans and four officers for the duration of the event. Horry County will incur any additional costs which may occur as a result of this request. With that, I'll be glad to answer any questions you may have.
Any questions? Matt, we entertain a motion to authorize our county administrator to enter into next week's agreement.
So moved.
Probably move.
Mr. Chairman, I think the most you're looking for is to adopt a resolution.
Well, I was going on the information request that he made directly. But if what the county needs to do, Major urges to adopt a resolution, I think that's the motion that we're entertaining.
I withdraw my motion. I would entertain a motion approving a resolution. Is that what we're doing? Ratifying a resolution? Adopting a resolution?
If I can clarify, the resolution, the agreement will be signed as a part of the resolution. So the major urge is correct. There is an agreement that I'll be signing if this motion passes and council is adopted. But the resolution is what is needed in order to be in compliance.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we adopt a resolution ratifying a mutual aid agreement between Spartanburg County Sheriff's Office and Horry County.
Move a second.
Second.
Probably move in seconds. And all in favor be known as aye.
Aye.
None opposed? We'll send out a full council. Thank you, Major. Our next item is to receive information and take desired action in reference to a request from the Sheriff's Office to apply for a grant to add four investigators at the Sheriff's Office. Captain Berry is here to present.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Real quick background, methamphetamine use in Spartanburg County is, I wouldn't call it epidemic, but it's very, very high in Spartanburg County in the state of South Carolina. We have our narcotics division and our chief chemist who actually respond to any meth lab that is found in Spartanburg County. And it doesn't just stop there. Once you find the lab, you make appropriate charges, you clean the lab up, and then you dispose of all the chemicals. So it's a long, tedious process. Our narcotics officers have been doing this around the clock, and Lieutenant Cooper came to us several months ago requesting assistance, and we are seeking a state grant to fund four positions for methamphetamine or meth lab investigators. It's a $433,000 grant with a 10% match, which we would use forfeiture funds to be on the county match. It's a 3-year grant. Each year you have to reapply to get another year, but we feel pretty good that we can get it for 3 years. Any questions?
Not, would I can entertain a motion to approve the grant application being submitted?
Not so moved.
I'll second that.
It's probably moved and second. All in favor, let it be known as aye.
Aye.
None opposed?
Thank you.
Send it to full council. Thanks, sir. Next item is to receive information and take desired action in reference to a request from the coroner's office to submit a grant application for a firehouse subs public safety foundation grant. Our coroner, Mr. Rusty Clemmer, is here to present.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman.
Afternoon.
I'm requesting to be able to put in for a grant to the organization. You mentioned the amount of $7,700 for a piece of equipment that will be 100% match, no cost to Spartanburg County, in addition to our unit and mass disaster unit that is manned by
any questions? If not, entertain a motion to approve the grant application.
Move to approve, Mr. Bradley.
I second that.
Probably move a second. All in favor, let it be known by the sign of aye.
Aye.
None opposed? Thank you. We'll send this to full council for its consideration.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir.
Anything from you, Mr. Chairman?
Council, anybody has any questions?
Thank you.
I'll commit to eating my fair share of brisket.
He gets his firehouse sandwiches.
I like a cookie bread.
Free coupons, Rusty.
You want to do the same thing?
Oh, Mark, I have a problem with you.
I did have one question, if I can ask him. What happens after 3 years?
After the third year, they would like the county to pick up at least 1 year. But it being a grant, what we like to do is do all the statistics and see if we'll get our bank or our buck, so to speak. So it would be based on statistics, what we get after 3 years. That's what I recommend.
Mr. Chairman, I can add to that. There may be some grant stipulations that say that the positions have to be retained, but with the Sheriff's Department being so large, I'm sure that we can work with a budget to allow turnover and others to synchronize with the need to keep those officers, if that becomes a requirement for it.
Thanks. And our last item to come before the committee is to receive information and take desired action related to magistrate court positions. And since we know there's been some extensive planning and talk, County Administrator Catherine O'Neill will discuss this.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I've provided some information at your place. I'd like to just review for the benefit of all of council. The South Carolina statute, there's a particular section 22-1-10A. And the part of the statute that I want to call your attention to is that at least 90 days before the commencement of the terms provided, and every 4 years thereafter, each county government body must inform in writing the senators representing that county of the number of full-time and part-time magistrate positions available in the county, the number of work hours required by each position, the compensation for each position, and the area of the county to which each position is assigned. So this is an administrative responsibility that county council has. It's our understanding that the current magistrate terms will end April 30th, 2015. It's also our understanding that the state statute related to magistrate appointments allocates 11.25 full-time equivalent magistrate positions to Spartanburg County, a formula for each of the 46 counties as far as magistrate allocations. So just to be sure that we're together on what 11.25 full-time equivalent means, it means that for every part-time position, it counts as 0.25 FTE, and for every full-time, it counts as one. So if you take a look at what our magistrate appointments are in Spartanburg County, we currently have 9 full-time positions. We have 7 in the courthouse and 2 in the detention center. So if you take 11.25 and you subtract 9, that leaves you 2.25 FTE. And I'm sorry to get in the weeds with the math, but it helps to walk through how many appointments that results in. So if you have 11.25 full-time equivalents and you have 9 full-time positions currently, then that leaves 2.25 positions. And right now, if you take 2.25 and you divide by 0.25, you get 9 additional part-time positions that would be available. And so we currently have 4 positions. If you'll see on the second page of your handout, we currently have 4 part-time positions in the detention center. And I know that council, you've worked closely with the sheriff to make sure that the jail operations provide the most efficient service for our citizens who are incarcerated. So as a result of that, the magistrate court helps out a lot by providing 3 shifts of bond hearings, and the full-time and part-time magistrates there help a lot with keeping that schedule going. I think you can imagine trying to run 24 hours a day with those types of operations requires additional staff. So if you have 9 full-time magistrates and then 4 part-time magistrates helping the detention center operation, that leaves 5 additional positions. And you'll see in the second page that what you would be offering to the senators is really a geographic distribution of the remaining five district magistrate positions around the county. So Packlet, the Greer, Woodruff, Reedville area, the Boiling Springs area, the Inman Landrum area, and Chesney. So the chart that you see here would fulfill the requirements of the statute by sharing not only the positions, whether they're full-time or part-time, the number of hours required by each position, and then the salary, really, of the existing magistrates that are in those positions now. So what you would provide as far as benefits to the magistrates would be the individual insurance benefits for any of the full-time magistrates. So the county offers group insurance benefits through the, as you know, the state, it's the South Carolina Public Employee Benefit Authority, PIBA, and eligibility for those benefits is set by PIBA through their employee insurance program. So the magistrates who are appointed to these positions who meet those eligibility requirements that are set by PIBA would be able to participate in those programs. And on the last page, I've offered you what our current magistrate locations are so that you have an opportunity to see that as well. And I'd be glad to answer any questions that you may have.
I've got a question, Mr. Chairman. Catherine, how many, can you just give us a rundown about how many magistrates we currently have in Spartanburg County for full and part-time?
Sure. I can give you, first let me give you the number of magistrates. So we currently have 10 magistrates assigned to the courthouse, 6 to the detention center, 1 in Landrum, 2 in Boiling Springs, and then 1 each in Inman, Reedville, Woodruff, Packlet, Chesney, and Greer. So it'd be a total of 25 magistrates.
Okay.
And there's, as you may be aware, the county works in its judicial operations at a 37.5-hour work week. In order to be full-time for the purpose of the statute considers a magistrate assigned to work 40 hours a week to be full-time.
Okay, and your proposal goes to 9 and 9, is that correct? Or 10?
Well, this is
9 and 9?
This is certainly a proposal.
A proposal.
I wouldn't want to suggest that, I certainly know, although I've seen the caseloads and have worked with magistrate court on this, I'm proposing that the district magistrate offices are geographically dispersed to the largest population centers or the ones that may have to travel the farthest from the central court.
Okay. Can you give me kind of an indication of like comparable counties, how many magistrates they have currently?
Sure. As you've been approaching this decision, several of you have asked me questions about some of the larger counties in South Carolina, about the number of magistrates that are assigned. In Charleston County, there are 7 full-time and 10 part-time magistrates. In Greenville County, there are 15 full-time and 6 part-time. I think they have a slightly different configuration for district offices, and I'm not an expert on that specifically. In Horry County, they have 10 full-time magistrates and no part-time. In Lexington County, they have 9 full-time magistrates and no part-time magistrates. In Richland County, there are 15 full-time and 3 part-time. In Spartanburg County, there's 25 magistrates I just listed off.
Okay.
Yes, sir. You stated to start with that there's a formula. I don't say we got to go through the formula, but it's determined on the size, I would take it, of the county and the population, or.
Sure. The statute breaks down what the allocation per county will be for magistrates, and there's a combination of different factors. Instead of trying to interpret the factor, we simply contacted court administration and they told us that based on that formula, we have 11.25 full-time equivalent magistrates.
So basically what you've shared with us with the other counties is probably some that's in, they're in the same name. I mean, Lexington, we've got 11 and a half and they've got 9, right? Is that what I'm reading?
Well, I didn't ask the question about whether the Lexington County allocation was a flat 9.
Oh, all right. So we just know that's what they've got.
Correct. They have 9. Well, I know that I know specifically that Lycoming County doesn't have any part-time magistrates.
Right.
But I did not ask court administration whether they had any additional beyond nine magistrates.
I understand. So I was just trying to get a feel, you know, for where we're setting with the number that we've got versus what the other counties and so forth. All right, thank you.
Chairman, I got one more question. Can you kind of give me an indication over the years, what the difference is between revenue from a magistrate's office versus our expenses over the last several years?
Sure. The revenues and expenditures that have been, that I just had an opportunity to take a look at based on some of the questions that you guys had prepared for this meeting. The revenue for the magistrate court, for example, in 2009, was $2,968,164. And the expenditure was just over $3 million, so $3,080,277. So if you take that as a deficit, there would be a shortfall of $112,113. And in all honesty, that's pretty close for a budget where you are trying to project revenues based on fines and collections and things like that. So over the years, you've seen the revenue reduce. So I'll just give you some examples. In fiscal year 10, the revenue reduced from that 2.9 number that I gave you, 2.9 million, to just under 2.6 million. And then in fiscal year 11, it reduced to 2.5 million roughly. In fiscal year 12, it reduced to 2.425 million. Fiscal year 13, 2.3 million, and so on. And it has continued to reduce. So we're somewhere in the neighborhood of 2.3 million. On the expenditure side, the expenditures have increased for the magistrate court, started out, as I shared with you, in fiscal year 09 as $3 million. And it stayed in that $3 million area, even though the revenues were falling, but now has increased to about $3.4 million. So if you look at the shortfall or deficit for the departments, and keep in mind that the magistrate's office is not assigned to have a balanced budget, right? But the reality is that the revenue expenditures are creating a shortfall that started out at $112,000 and now it's over $1 million shortfall for the department. There are a number of things that can contribute to that. We had five additional magistrates appointed during that same time period, and I know that we've gone through a really rough economic time, so I know that fines and fees and those types of things can also track downward, but it is $1 million gap that we're looking at in our department, additional staff.
So with the gain of five magistrates, we had a loss of roughly $700,000 a year.
Sure, but Councilman, that in all fairness, the part-time magistrates wouldn't represent that total amount. But it is, those are additional expenditures to hire additional staff.
Right, I mean, I was talking about the revenue loss.
Oh, yes, sir.
Yeah, we had a $700,000 revenue loss, even though we had five extra additional magistrates during that time. Okay.
I'm not on the committee, Mr. Chairman. Can I say a quick word? I mean, it goes back to our 2:30 meeting we have with Mr. Weathers. You know, one of our seven items we should be able to give our employees salary increase that they need and they deserve. Also, it ties into the local government fund issue that we've been debating. I mean, I applaud our chairman, our administrator, the legal team, and staff for pulling this together. I mean, you don't have to be a rocket scientist to look at these numbers. I mean, this started in 09 when we were faced with the worst economic, you know, recession that we've ever seen in our lifetimes, and hopefully we'll never see again. In 09, they go from 20 magistrates to 25 as a cost, as Roger just pointed out, almost $700,000 in revenue, I mean, cuts, and then expenses going up almost $400,000. we couldn't afford it in '09. We had a deficit of $112,000 that year, and so we just added on to it. So the employees that work in the county, I mean, all the folks that are out here right now, this is part of where your pay increase is going. And I applaud our chairman and his team for saying enough is enough. And finding out the legal, deal, but again, I had no idea that this existed, that we had to notify our senators, 45 days or 90 days before this thing ended, that we're not going to do it. We're going to pay what we need. And you look at those other six counties, Lexington, Charleston, Greenville, Horry, and Richland, if they can do it for a whole heck of a lot less than we can, we need to get on board. So, again, I applaud y'all for developing and finding this information out, and for us, at least entertaining, standing up for what's right, and no more taking it. Because not only are employees losing their the taxpayers of Spartanburg are paying for this. And we've been paying it for a long time blindly, so enough is enough.
Mr. Chairman, just a point of clarification. Magistrates are appointed by the Senate end of our county delegation, is that correct?
That's correct. In fact, the statute does require us to inform the senators themselves directly.
The deficit that we see in fiscal year 14, let's just use this one as an example. The deficit is $1,049,000. Who pays that deficit?
Well, Council of Hollywood, the county has paid.
The county pays this deficit.
And to be specific about it, the county has a list of mandates that exceed the local government fund allocation. This is one of them.
And this is one of them that should be paid out of what we get from local government funding. But once again, we see that we are in deficit with local government funding. Is that correct? So this then comes out of our budget to make amends.
Yes.
Just wanted to clarify that. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir. I just want to say that recently our chairman has made some comments stating our council's resolve to do everything we can, and everything is on the table. And I want to tell you right now, especially from this committee, from what I'm hearing, we're going to take every opportunity that we can. And when we look at this situation here where we've got running a deficit in a situation, and we have a statute in the law that says that we control certain aspects of the magistrate system, I think we intend to exercise our control. And I don't want anybody in this state or this county to look at Spartanburg and say, are they going to do what they say or not, because we are going to act. And so, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion, if I may. I would like to move that we authorize our county administrator to send a letter to the Senate delegation informing the senators representing Spartanburg County that there will be 9 full-time magistrate positions and 9 part-time magistrate positions available in Spartanburg County when the new terms commence May 1st, 2015, and providing corresponding information that was covered here today by about the location of work hours and compensation and benefits for those positions.
I second.
Probably moved in second. Any questions or discussion?
Mr. Chairman, I do want to point out, I know I pointed this out this afternoon, but for the benefit of the audience, the senators who are a part of our delegation did support unanimously the full funding of local government fund. So I want to be sure that everyone who's involved in this conversation recognizes that the complete funding of local government fund is a responsibility of the General Assembly as a whole, and our senators unanimous in their support of full funding. They recognize this deficit. So I know there's been a lot of discussion about that. Because some of the audience may not have been here earlier this afternoon, they may not have heard that discussion about council. And I want to be fair to our Senate delegation as part of this discussion.
One question I do have that complements this, from what the administration is looking at and what council is looking at, the magistrate court system won't be the only area that we're identifying that may have to have similar actions.
Well, the timing of this is because of the statute. The at least 90 days before the commencement of new terms, council has to take an action. During the budget process, the chairman has asked me to prepare a budget for council that helps you go through and look at specifically the mandates that you're required to, you're required to provide, the mandates you're required to cover, and then how much revenue is coming in, so that you have the best opportunity to make decisions about how to manage that shortfall.
So at some point?
Yes, sir. There will be other discussions about how to right size the budget.
Any other questions or comments? It's been properly moved in second. All that in favor, let me know in his eye.
Aye.
None opposed. We'll send this to the full council for its consideration. Mr. Chairman, those are all items that have come before the committee.
Thank you, Mr. Brown. No items on the land use today. We do have some items on the public works. Honorable Roger Nutt, Chairman, David Griff, Justin Bradley, members, Mr. Nutt.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Let's talk about something a little more enjoyable. The Public Works Infrastructure Fund is whatever we're going to call it, we have some distance, I think, in our meeting meetings. But this is a fund where I envision, and this committee, I hope, will envision that we start putting the money aside to be proactive, to get infrastructure updated and upgraded, and overall benefit of our citizens and make a safer, more livable community, and to be proactive for growth areas in our county. And I've asked Ms. O'Neill to kind of put some information together and kind of give me some feedback on the proposal. Ms. O'Neill.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As I understand the proposal that you have, you're looking for an established funding mechanism to take care of special infrastructure projects that may come up during the year that we're not anticipating when we were going through the budget process, per se. And an example I think we talked about during our strategic visioning session earlier today was a commercial project that was coming into a neighborhood where they needed some type of grocery facility and other where they can make other purchases for household supplies. And the location that the developers were looking at was going to impact a subdivision where we were having some stormwater problems. We know those stormwater problems are there. A lot of these subdivisions were installed prior to standards set by the county. And so we ended up having a great opportunity for a public-private partnership where the developers were willing to pay for part of the stormwater improvements in the county would pay for the other. That would either be less than if we took on the project ourselves some other time. But I think Councilman Britt, you and I were talking about being in that meeting where that was really one of the last meetings I had with Steve Ballou, where he talked about how to cobble together the funds in order to make that project work. And I think if I understood part of what your hope is that in those instances we would have a fund to turn to say, let's just use this particular public works infrastructure fund to take care of that. And that as we continue to grow, when these projects come up and we need to have a funding resource to go, that we don't rob other projects in order to take care of that opportunity. So I think you had talked with me about possibly $200,000 to $250,000 that you'd like to see in the upcoming budget, more as a capital improvement project that would be part of the CIP, and that any funds that weren't used from that particular fund, if you will, or project account, they'd roll over to the next year so they could accumulate in years to come, and perhaps grow an amount that would give council and staff more flexibility when we're trying to address them with these needs. It's by no means the final solution to all of our infrastructure problems, and I don't think that you portrayed it that way, or that it's going to accumulate to an amount that would be able to widen a two-lane road to five. I don't think that's what you're envisioning at all, if I understood you correctly.
That's correct.
So we can certainly do that if I took from the meeting earlier today that that was a win, an outcome that council felt if you could look at
into the future and be a year ahead, you'd like to be able to call out those projects that you were able to use this money for. So we'll be working as a team to set that up if that's council's desire, which it sounds to be your desire, under the parameters that you guys will establish for us. But the funding will be ready for you during the budget process.
Okay. David, can you talk about what that would do for economic development and other things?
As Catherine pointed out, we're not talking about huge projects, but there are a lot of small things that need to be tapped, you know, that can be moved along, and it would make a big difference. You don't think $250,000 is a lot, but you know, traffic lights at an intersection, for instance, or you know, some stormwater runoff issues like that, it can make a big difference. So I'd like to make a motion that we approve this public works infrastructure fund up to $250,000 initially and name it the Steve Ballou Fund. Since Steve was the one, as Captain pointed out, I mean, in a 5-minute meeting when he started doing this little brainstorming, you know, with his history that he had, and he was so proactive and results oriented, he came up with it. So I'd like for us to name this fund the Steve Ballou Fund as well.
I'll second that motion. Mr. Chairman, if I could just briefly, I appreciate your leadership in coming up with a solution like this. I think this is a great example of us being proactive, not being reactive to problems that come up, thinking into the future and realizing that there are going to be things that come up throughout the year that we're going to need some funding for, and setting that aside off the top so that we know the funding's there and the government doesn't become an obstacle to economic growth. We can be there as a partner. So I appreciate your leadership on this.
Absolutely. We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion?
Mr. Chairman, if I may ask for clarification, this motion has to go ahead and establish the fund. Was that during the upcoming budget process?
Yes.
For fiscal year 16?
Yes, 16.
Thank you.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Can I ask a question?
Yes, sir.
Number one, I'm in favor of what you're talking about doing. The only thing is, I'm a little concerned that we're doing a motion tonight, and I'm not saying we're not ready to vote, but I know that there's a lot of disagreement going on the state level with the infrastructure bank and how that's structured and everything. And I don't want us to get tied to something like that, so be aware of that. The other thing is, I'm hearing from the people in my district, and these are small businesses, and we do a great job, and we proved our leadership and how we by assistance and aid to those large corporations. But I'm a little concerned with setting them out and what we want to do. I would like to see us somewhere along the way come up with a formula. And my thoughts have been, in talking with some of my friends that's in the development business and so forth, when you really look at a large development, you take the number of houses, just houses alone that's going into that development, and you look at the amount of taxes that we're getting from those new pieces of value on our books, I would like for us to come up with some way that we can work with those developers before they get going and get some idea. And they're willing to help us. They don't like to be hit on the back end of it, like you've had experience and I'm having one right now. We've got county roads that dump into state roads. They're going to develop on the county roads, and we're having to do that, but we don't do anything with the state roads, like you say, an intersection or something there. So I'm not saying we don't do what you're saying tonight. I'm just saying I was at a position, maybe a little more discussion, and come up with the exact way we want to set it up. I haven't talked to administration yet, so I'm catching them off guard, but I was following your leadership that we were going to talk about it tonight, but I would like to see us come up with some way. I mean, I think there's more that we can do than $250,000 in an account. Now that's a good start, yes, but I think there's some words that there's, just look at sometimes yours and my developments as to how many new houses are coming once we get there. Most of those people probably got two cars, so you got, you know, property taxes coming there. It's going to go on our roads. I'm just trying to tie it some ways that way.
Okay.
Councilman. So I defer to what y'all decide to do, but that would be my suggestion.
I think, David, you said to set up the fund.
Yes.
Basically.
Just to set, and I don't see this. I mean, when we work on a company coming here, and the truth is, when you look at our economic development results, the overwhelming majority of companies that we have expanding and investing here are small companies. But, you know, they're not the Torres and the BMWs. Those are the ones that get a lot of attention.
But I'm talking about us poor people now.
Yeah, what I'm saying is most of the companies that we recruit here are expansions are small companies that are here. 85% of our announcements are from existing industry. And a lot of those wouldn't be touched by something like this because we generally take the tax dollars that they generate and give them incentives to do and help themselves. Things like this would be mainly for some, you know, stormwater issues, like on this particular project over in Arcadia, and other small items. I mean, we're not talking about big things, but can make a big difference on a small commercial project, industrial, or it could be anything that we need that right now doesn't fit in our economic development, you know, arena. It could be most of this would be money used in a community that, you know, that's economically disadvantaged. And that's why I think it's a good thing to do.
It's not necessary, and I'm sorry, just to get into the discussion, it's not necessarily those economic development things that are moving in and coming. This is for things that may have been long existing, that finally we're being approached by the problem that is truly affecting a community and its residents. That's what Steve Ballou was all about. Yeah. He was about helping community and making sure things within that framework got taken care of. This isn't about roads. It isn't about bridges necessarily. This is about different issues that come up that we don't really anticipate and have no way of knowing until we're presented with the problem. $250,000 is a great starting point. It may be in a few years we see that fund needs to grow. We don't know. But at least I'd like to say that initial amount would be a good starting point for some of the projects that we see that aren't encompassed in some of the roads and bridges issues or CDBG funds or anything like that. So,
I'll just chime in real quick. We need to move forward, but the truth is, I gave a speech the other day to the Inman Rotary Club, and I had a tax bill with me. The bill was for $867. And I asked everyone in there to raise their hand and how much actually went towards Spartanburg County's operating budget. I had a lot of figures, but out of that 867, the county got 107 a day. So that's the truth about the tax bill. And Roger, I think it's a good program. We had one years ago that tried to transition dirt roads over in the county, and I think during the bad times that particular fund, you know, went away. So we just, you know, start with this and move forward, and I think we can have a better person to have this. And Mr. Steve Ballou, he's been a great asset to this county for a long time.
I agree. Anything else? Got a motion and a second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Okay, it passes. We'll recommend that to full council and see where it goes to full council. We also received activities of the Public Works Department. It's all in the packet. And Mr. Chairman, that's all we have.
All right, we're going to adjourn for about 5 minutes, and we will return. Okay, thank you for your attendance. Sorry for our tardiness. We did have a little long committee meeting today. The first item on our agenda is invocation, and we ask for Chaplain Amos Durham to come forward. Chaplain, how are you today?
Good.
Good to have you with us again.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
That's all, Stan. Let's pray. Our Father, our God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for how you continue to bless us. Thank you for your grace and your mercy. Thank you for health. Thank you for life and strength. We pray tonight for the citizens of Spartanburg County. We pray for peace. We pray for safety. We pray for unity. And we certainly thank you for our county administrators. Pray that you continue to give them the wisdom that they need to lead and to be effective in the work that you've called them to do. pray for county council. You will continue to endow them with the wisdom, knowledge, courage to make decisions that will be effective for the citizens of this county. We pray much for our meeting tonight as we go through our agenda. We pray that it's a sweet spirit and that what we discuss tonight will benefit those in whom the decision is to be made for. We thank you again for all that you do in our life. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Mr. Durham, I want to thank you. You had some large shoes to fill. You're doing a very, very good job. Thank you, sir, for being with us.
Thank you.
Sir. Now we have our Pledge of Allegiance. Now I've asked Mr. Jim Greer if he would lead us.
I remain standing. Attention to the flag. Salute. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Item 2, we have item A, a resolution designating the month of January 15th as Slavery and Human Trafficking Awareness and Prevention Month. Spartanburg County, represented by Mr. Justin Bradley, and I would like to welcome to the first official, I guess, meeting, Justin Bradley and Bob Walker as well. Good to have you two gentlemen with us.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It's my privilege today to be able to present this resolution. Earlier in the month, on Human Trafficking Awareness Day, I had the privilege of hosting a rally that we had about 50 people come out to stand against human trafficking. This is an issue that I'm passionate about, mainly because the largest targets of human trafficking, unfortunately, are children. And it's something that we absolutely should take a stand for and raise awareness, because if we raise awareness about the issue and we are able to help educate people about the risk and things to look for, we have an opportunity to be able to protect our children and make sure that they don't become a victim. You know, a lot of people look at human trafficking and think of traveling, or they think of things happening abroad. This absolutely is an issue that happens, unfortunately, in our own backyard. We have to look no further than the recent operation by the sheriff's office, where they uncovered a trafficker just in October of last year that was coming across our interstates. So we absolutely have to be diligent about this. We have to be willing to take a stand. And this is part of National Human Trafficking Awareness Month, which gives us all an opportunity to be able to stand up and learn about the issue and learn what we can do as individuals, as local businesses about it. If I could, I'd ask Sheriff Wright to join me for this resolution. Now, I'll just read this resolution. A resolution designating the month of January 2015 as Slavery and Human Trafficking Awareness and Prevention Month in Spartanburg County. Whereas human trafficking, often referred to as modern-day slavery, is defined as the use of force, fraud, or coercion to induce a state of involuntary servitude against another human being, it can take the form of labor trafficking, sex trafficking, or both. Whereas human trafficking is recognized as a global problem which exists internationally and affects an estimated 21 million people annually, according to studies, including an estimated 5.5 million children and minors. Whereas human trafficking is not only a problem that happens abroad, United States citizens, including South Carolina citizens, are also among those trafficked and at risk for becoming trafficking victims. Whereas the annual observance of National Slavery and Human Trafficking Prevention Month is designed to raise public awareness about the issues surrounding human trafficking, the plight of victims affected by it, and encourage individuals, businesses, nonprofits, faith leaders, and governments to recognize the vital role they can each play in all forms of modern slavery. Whereas Spartanburg County supports the efforts by the South Carolina Attorney General's Human Trafficking Task Force to bring the issue of human trafficking to light and recognize the vital role local, state, and federal prosecutors and investigators play in bringing human traffickers to justice within our borders and throughout the state. Now, therefore, be it resolved that Spartanburg County Council does hereby declare January 2015 as Slavery and Human Trafficking Awareness and Prevention Month in Spartanburg County, adopted this 26th day of January 2015, signed by Chairman Jeffrey A. Wharton and Catherine Neal, County Administrator. Mr. Chairman, I'd like to entertain a motion to adopt the resolution.
I have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, I vote affirmative, and it passes.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Bradley. I appreciate that.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Matt?
Yes, absolutely. Please.
I thank you so much for this. I'll accept this on behalf of all the Spartanburg County deputies that do a great job every single day. If you guys could have seen that young boy that we uncovered, he was stashed up underneath a dash. I mean, he hadn't eaten anything in a couple of days. He was under the surmise that he was going to work in a better life, but actually he was going to be traded for drug trade. He's the same age as one of my sons, and that just hit me very hard. So I appreciate very kindly this resolution, and I'll accept it on behalf of the hard-working officers everywhere. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Appreciate that.
Thank you, Justin. Next, we have item 3, employee recognition, Catherine O'Neill. Catherine?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of council. Certainly, it's my pleasure this evening to recognize a number of individuals who, as the ambassadors of Spartanburg County, have certainly shown why this is the finest county in which to live. The first recognition is really of a partner, and that's the United Way of Spartanburg. I think Doug Eberhardt and Heather Wynn, I see you both are here tonight. If you guys would stand up for the rest of the group to see you. I think Councilman Bradley has a few things he'd like to share about something that you did that was very special for a constituent who had contacted him. Councilman Bradley?
Yeah, absolutely. So right before Christmas, I actually received on my Facebook page a message from a constituent who was homeless, who was going through some obstacles as a family. And obviously leading into the holiday season, it was a huge problem for them. And so I immediately reached out to Catherine, and she was able to put me in touch with the right resources. Appreciate your partnership that we have. They were able to jump immediately in, get in contact with his family, and immediately get them into the right place to find some resources leading into the holidays. So really appreciate your help. It's absolutely an essential partnership for us. It's essential that we have these safety net resources for individuals when they have those hard times within our community. So thank you.
Doug, Heather, thank you so much. Next, I'd like to recognize a new member of our management team. No stranger to you, but I'd like to reintroduce him this evening as our new director of the Emergency Services Academy, Chris Massey. If you'll stand, please. I wanted to tell council a little bit more about Chris's background, and for the members of the audience, we're very excited, Chris, to have you as part of the senior management team. Again, you're no stranger to Spartanburg County. You have really grown up through the ranks here in the county, and I certainly appreciated the opportunity to work with you in the interim capacity as ESA director. You've taken advantage of that opportunity to show me just how great you're going to be as a manager. Chris brings 15 years of experience in various public safety capacities, including the last 7 years as the ESA Assistant Director. The selection panel was unanimous in their assertion that Chris demonstrated a strong grasp of the position requirements and displayed a level of passion for the programs and service provided, unlike any other candidate. I can say, and I know that I shared this with Jim as well, that working closely with him as he served in the interim, that Chris is totally committed to making certain that ESA meets all of the needs of the public safety agencies, particularly fire departments and the sheriff's department. Chris, I know that council's seen you here, but I wanted to point out that you are singularly responsible for the success of our county rookie firefighter school. Chris holds various certifications. I think you're going into your 1 year class. How many rookie firefighter classes have you graduated?
There are 12th one right now, I'm climbing the 13th.
And that's almost 200?
Over 200 students so far.
Chris holds various certifications in firefighting, emergency management, and the emergency medical technician. He's also recognized by the South Carolina Fire Academy as a certified fire instructor. Chris also serves the county as a valuable member of the fire investigation team. Council, if you'll join me in welcoming Chris to our senior management team. Sitting next to him there, I see Doug Bryson. And Doug, if you wouldn't mind standing up, I think I have a council member who'd like to thank you for some help. Councilman Britt, I think you brought to my attention that Doug helped one of your constituents through a serious situation related to explosives that was found in a home that he inherited. I want to share, ask you to share that story.
Sure. In fact, he's a constituent, also an associate of mine at Tyndall, bought a house and found out that it had a large amount of explosives all the way back to World War II. He didn't understand what it was, but just knew he had a problem. So he asked me about it. I got in touch with Doug. Doug put together a team and went out and took care of him very quickly, and it could have been a very, very serious situation. But, you know, Doug got someone, got the gentleman who's a lieutenant from the Sheriff's Department.
Ashley Harris, perhaps?
I first contacted Lieutenant Michael Horton, Sergeant Michael Horton, and he took it from there.
Yeah, jumped on it and just gave quick service and took care of him. And Scott singing the county's praises, and Doug Bryson, he said, not only do I get those good weather alerts, but it keeps my children and my family safe. Doug, thank you for the good work.
It's going quite so fast. Doug was recently at the council. I wanted to share his announcement. He appointed as president of the International Association of Emergency Managers, Region 4, at its yearly conference this year. The International Association of Emergency Managers, which has more than 9,000 members worldwide, is the preeminent international nonprofit organization of emergency management professionals. Region 4, which is comprised of 8 states, Kentucky, Tennessee, North and South Carolina, Georgia, Alabama, Mississippi, and Florida, is the largest of the 10 regions in the U.S. with approximately 1,600 members. For the next 2 years, Doug will serve as president of Region 4, an honor only bestowed upon a few select emergency managers. I saw a news release related to this, and I noticed a quote that I wanted to share with you. When asked about his new position, Doug stated, "There's no greater honor than to be recognized by your peers. The next 2 years will be an exciting endeavor, one that I'm proud to undertake." And Doug, we are so proud that you're undertaking it. You represent us so well. Thank you. Next, I'd like to ask Chris Jennings and Jim Campbell, if you guys all stand. I know you're representing a number of individuals tonight. I don't know whether everyone knows this, but Spartanburg County Tourism Group received the National Reader's Choice Award. So hosting major sporting events and teams from across the country continues to reap the rewards. The Spartanburg Convention and Visitors Bureau was recently notified that it had received another Reader's Choice Award by Sports Events Media Group. We are honored to be one of only 2 winners in South Carolina. This is the second time in 3 years that we've been recognized for our sports tourism work. And of course, Council, I think you'll join me in thanking all of our partners throughout Spartanburg County and the new Tiger River Park Sports Complex, which has been the center point of this particular notation. Sport events professionals were asked to name the Sports Commission, Convention, and Visitors Bureau, or sport event venue that they believe displays exemplary creativity and professionalism toward the groups they host. Nominations were received from readers throughout the year, and the top picks were selected based on the results from an online voting system. Chris and Jim, you guys have done everything you could to put Spartanburg County on the map, and I am so proud, and I know Council joins me in this, that we received another award, and one that I think is even more special because it was the individuals who've been at the site and been part of the experience of Spartanburg County who voted for it. So congratulations to both of you. Please extend that congratulations to the rest of your team. And next, I'd like to ask Dorothy Earl, Bobby Metz, and Earl Alexander, if you guys will stand. I wanted to acknowledge what was amazing that you guys did that caught the attention of a reader of the Herald Journal. The stroller column included this letter recently. It says, "Blessed. Give those folks a raise," which may be a possibility, I heard earlier today. "That might be in order after hearing about Spartanburg resident Charles Wilbank's recent dealings with the Spartanburg County offices of treasurer, assessor, register of deeds, and delinquent tax." Earl is over here. There you are, Earl. "I have been very impressed with all of the people whom I've dealt with. says Mr. Wilbanks. They have been exceedingly courteous, helpful, and knowledgeable. My contacts were both in person and by telephone. Spartanburg County is blessed to have such great public servants. Mr. Wilbanks couldn't have said it any better. You guys are in the position of telling no to a lot of people, delivering news they didn't want to hear, and dealing with long lines, and you do it so well. I know leadership starts at the top. Your teams are exemplary, and so are you. Thank you so much for providing whatever service you provide to Mr. Wilbanks and hundreds of other taxpayers who you serve so well. Thank you. And lastly, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to ask Paulette Carter, Lisa Hart, Terry Booker, Tony Bell, Bob Parkrader, and Gary Splon. If you guys would stand up, please. All right, so when something really goes wrong in this building, this is the team that you want there to help you in an emergency. We had a citizen who actually had a seizure in our building, and the folks that you see here did not miss a beat in taking care of that citizen. They were doing what they do in their departments and saw that one of our citizens were in need and took care of them. Paulette, I have heard about your gentle demeanor with this person, firm and gentle demeanor to try to help them stay calm and get the help that they need, their medical help. So to you personally, I say thank you. I know you just happened to be there at that time and the rest of you stepped in to help Paulette. I'm so proud of you. This had a good outcome. But certainly, if anything happens in this building, be around this group, because they're going to take really good care of you. So thank you, you guys. You did a great job that day. I appreciate you putting aside any of your personal concerns about helping somebody and just making sure that they were safe. Thank you so much. Mr. Chairman, I think that's all I have. That's a gracious pleasure.
Okay, thank you. Next, we'll go to public hearings. Open item 8, to consider an uncodified ordinance to grant a utility easement to Broad River Electric Cooperative to install an electric transformer to serve facilities associated with the expansion of Bottom Arm of Bellum Park. Anyone speak on behalf of this public hearing? None seen. Close A. Item B, to consider an ordinance to develop a jointly owned and operated industrial business park, which is Project Big Ben, in conjunction with Cherokee County. Anyone to speak on behalf of this public? None seen, close B. Earlier today, we had our committees, and the first committee is Economic Improvement and Development, chaired by Honorable David Britt. Britt?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We had two items that the committee recommends to full council. The first being a request to approve an amendment of agreement for development of a joint county industrial park between Cherokee and Spartanburg County for Cherokee County's project named New Idea. Mr. Chairman, I move that we approve this amendment to the agreement.
Have a motion. Second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? I vote affirmative. It passes. Thank you.
The next item, the committee recommends full council that we approve and authorize our county administrator, Catherine O'Neill, to execute the agreement regarding a sewer infrastructure improvement agreement with Spartanburg Sanitary Sewer District. Chairman, I move that we approve and authorize our administrator to do so.
Have a motion.
Second.
And a second under item C. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? Vote affirmative and it passes.
That concludes our committee report.
Thank you, Mr. Britt. No items under public health today. We did have personnel and finance. Honorable Bob Walker, Chairman. Mr. Walker.
Mr. Chairman, the personnel and finance committee approved and approval of two SPATS positions that were previously been unfrozen, was frozen to unfreeze them, and we move that we approve these requests.
All right, we have a motion from the committee on A.
Second.
And a second. But this item, we needed some clarification to cover.
Yes. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. In fiscal year, Councilman, in fiscal year 06, we had 18 positions in the planning department. So that would be planning and stats and money. In fiscal year 15, we have 17 positions, four of which are frozen. So an action by council would unfreeze two of those positions. So 17 were 18 positions in fiscal year 06, 17 positions in fiscal year 15, four of which are currently frozen.
So we have 14 active, you said?
13 active. 13 active.
And then with the two additional, that will bring us up to 15 in that department.
Right, so still less than what we had in the full year.
So we still haven't gotten back up to the same level as far as personnel that we were in 2006, even with the additional of these two spats.
That's right. Positions.
Any other questions? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? One affirmative. It passes. Thank you.
All right, Mr. Chairman, the Personnel and Finance Committee heard a request for reclassification from the auditor's assessor's office to change the classification for a position and raise the grade, and the committee approved this, moves that we approve this recommendation.
All right, we have a motion on the leave.
Second.
And a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? No vote affirmative, and it passes.
Committee also received information from the Sheriff's Department concerning the request to reclassify administrative position, and the committee approved this reclassification, and we move for the adoption.
Right, we have a motion on C.
Second.
And a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? No vote affirmative, and it passes.
And, Mr. Chairman, we also heard a request from the Sheriff's Department to convert a sworn position to a civilian position, and the committee approved this request, and we move for adoption.
All right, we have a motion on D.
Second.
And a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? No vote affirmative, and it passes.
We also heard from the Clerk of Court's office to reclassify a senior account clerk, which was a part-time position, to title it a senior clerk, a senior court clerk, make it a full-time position, and the committee approved this reclassification and moved for adoption.
We have a motion on E.
So moved.
And a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? No vote affirmative, and it passes.
We also heard from Spartanburg Alcohol and Drug Abuse about changes in reclassification and grades of some of the staff that need to be handled in that department. Also to unfreeze a slot and make it active, and the committee approved these requests and move for adoption.
Have a motion?
Second.
And a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? No affirmative, and it passes.
And we also received financial data and personnel vacancy report.
Thank you, Mr. Walker. Next, we have Livability Committee, Honorable Jane Hall, Chairman. Ms. Hall?
Yes, we had two items coming before us today. The first is to receive information in reference to a request from the Parks Department to apply for a grant from the Spartanburg County Foundation. We move to for approval of this grant application.
All right, we have a motion on A.
Second.
And a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your hand. All opposed? No vote affirmative, and it passes.
We also received information on the Parks Enhancement Plan. This is a detailed plan that is in your packets, and we took that as a motion to receive this plan as an update and a planning tool to assist in the upcoming budget process.
Okay. Have a motion. We have a second.
Second.
Second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your hand. All opposed? No vote affirmative, and it passes.
And that's all for our committee.
Thank you, Ms. Howell. Next, we have Public Safety and Judiciary, Honorable Michael Brown, Chairman. Mr. Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. First item is the committee received information and the request to take desired action in reference to a resolution ratifying the mutual aid agreement between the Spartanburg County Sheriff's Office and Oregon County. The committee recommends council, and I move that we adopt the resolution.
We have a motion. Second. And a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your hand. All opposed? No vote affirmative, and it passes.
Secondly, the committee received information and had requested take desired action in reference to a request from the sheriff's office to apply for a grant to add four investigators at the sheriff's office. Committee recommends to council, and I make a motion that we approve the request for the grant application submission.
We have a motion.
Second.
And a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your hand. All opposed, or vote affirmative, it passes.
Next, the committee received information and had requested take desired action in reference to a request from the coroner's office to submit a grant application for a firehouse subs public safety foundation grant. Committee recommends to council, and I make a motion that we approve the grant application submission.
I have a motion.
Second.
And a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your hand. All opposed, or vote affirmative, it passes.
Last item, committee received information and has a request to take desired action relating to the maximum court's position. The committee recommends, and on behalf of the committee, I move that the county administrator is authorized to send a letter to the Senate delegation informing the senators representing Spartanburg County that there will be 9 full-time magistrate positions and 9 part-time magistrate positions available in Spartanburg County, and the new term commences on May 1st, 2015. And to provide corresponding information that was covered here today about the locations, the work hours, the compensation, and benefits for such positions.
Okay, we have a motion from the committee.
Second.
And a second. Any other discussion?
Mr. Chairman, if I could have
just
three questions for county administrator. Any actions in recent times, since you did provide information about the comparative counties, have any of the other counties that you provided by way of comparison, have they done anything with their magistrate court positions?
Not that I'm aware of. We requested that information before the holidays, so I don't know if anyone has any appointments that are coming up at this time.
And of course, the increase that was noted in Spartanburg County would have been an increase that could potentially have affected other counties in the state based upon the census data.
The increase to the number of magistrates was a function of appointments. The county's allocation for magistrate appointments has remained 11.25. The magistrates were being added as part-time magistrates, so they only counted towards the allocation by 0.25.
As far as you know, was there any consideration based upon the growth of the actual population of our county as relates to the overall discussion of adding magistrates?
I wasn't part of the discussion, so I don't know.
And how many courtrooms do we have in the courthouse that are dedicated for magistrate court?
I don't know.
Any other questions?
If I may add to that, the number of full-time magistrates who are assigned to the courthouse would not change with what has been proposed. There are currently 7 full-time magistrates at the courthouse and 2 at the detention center, which ended up comprising the 9 full-time magistrates in this. This doesn't really change the full-time magistrates that are assigned to the county at this point.
In terms of the level of service that we provide as a county, if we were to change the numbers, there could be an immediate determination by you that this can impact our services here in this county.
I did have an opportunity to work through the case volumes for the different district offices. Councilman Brown, the mathematics really drives this. So if there's 11.25 magistrates that are assigned to Spartanburg County, and we already have 9, that only leaves 2.25 full-time equivalents. And if we have 4 part-time magistrates in the detention center, and that, it's my understanding, is what's needed in order to keep the 3 shifts running, then just by virtue of the numbers, if you will, that only leaves 5 part-time positions allocated to Spartanburg County for district offices. And so the attempt that we've done is to try to position those district offices where the largest population, thus the largest caseload and the most convenience for the citizens, really they ring around the city. So Packlet, Woodruff, Reedville, Greer, Chesney,
Inman, Landry, and Board of Schools.
Well, let me ask you this then. This is my final question. If through some miracle we were able to restructure our courthouse, or our courthouse expanded with additional courtrooms, because if you say we have the number of masters that we have in the courthouse, but less courtrooms actually for court to be conducted, if our courtrooms were to be expanded, in your vision, considering the masters that are now becoming full-time, would that impact how we can handle court?
Well, Councilman Brown, the 9 full-time magistrates that are there, they're full-time now. So this doesn't mean that they have any, that we're taking any part-time magistrates and making them full-time in the courthouse. I would imagine that if they're full-time there and there's a matter of efficiency with additional courtrooms, you certainly could work with the clerk of court to see if there's an opportunity for additional courtrooms they could hold or something like that, if that's what you're asking.
Yeah, then that wouldn't impact court anywhere else.
I'm not sure I understand your question, because the caseloads, as you may be aware, are assigned to the central court and then the district courts. So this is the district magistrate offices. So, well, I suppose that someone can choose, I suppose, where they have court, a district office or a downtown central court hearing. I don't know that to be absolute, but that's my understanding of it.
Yeah, since this was presented today, and it's the first time I've seen this information, and again, like I said earlier, I applaud administration and our chairman, you know, for bringing this to light. I never knew it. I never knew that we had this option of saying enough is enough. And I really wonder if some of those senators that are appointing these magistrates, if they really know the impact. They're going to know it tomorrow morning. And I think that's going to be a shock to some of them to find out that, you know, in 6 years from 09 to now fiscal year 14-15, it's pretty obvious to me when I look at those numbers, they're not covering the cost of what they're, you know, they were assigned and they created to do, serve the public, and also kind of break even. It's cost $1 million more than what it did in 09. Like I said before, you don't have to be a rocket scientist or, you know, real high on the math scale to figure those numbers just don't work. You know, if the other 5 counties, the largest counties in the state, can do it for less than what we're doing, we need to be there too. I look at our mission statement. You know, Spartanburg County provides a foundation for superior quality of life for residents, unlimited opportunities for business, and an exceptional learning environment for education through purposeful planning, investment, and uses of our resources. This is not a good use of our resources. It's something we can't afford, and I think these 3 senators will find out in short order that the state's not paying for this. The citizens of Spartanburg County are, and they will work with us to get the right numbers. So I'm looking forward to them giving us our 9 full-time and our 9 part-time, and let's do what we're elected to do, serve the citizens.
Any other questions, comments? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? I vote affirmative, it passes. Thank you, Mr. Brown.
All actions came before committee.
No items on the land use today. Public Works, Buildings and Grounds, Honorable Roger Nutt, Chairman.
Mr. Chairman, besides receiving information regarding our building, our Public Works Department activities, we also discussed a Public Works Infrastructure Fund, and the committee came together and we made a motion we approved a motion and want to provide that to the full council that we move forward with the infrastructure, Public Works Infrastructure Fund, which we'd like to name after Steve Ballou, after his great work in the county and trying to help others and trying to come up with new and innovative ways of doing so, instead of saying that we just can't do that right now. So we move that we proceed with the infrastructure fund and establishing it and establishing, I guess, the rules and procedures of whatever has to be done with that.
Business for our upcoming budget.
We
have a motion.
Second.
Any other discussion?
Mr. Chairman and Mr. Nutt, I'd just like to say that I think this is a great thing for us to have a pool of money that will be able to do certain projects that just don't qualify within the scheme of things. During our intermission, I did have a person come up to me very concerned that this would be something that would be used for developers when they had a shortfall or things like that. That is not the purpose of this fund. This fund is dedicated to the citizens of this county who may come across problems that just have no way of being solved other than having the county come in and assist them with these things. So I think it's very important for us to understand that that's what this money will be dedicated to.
Any other questions or comments? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, vote affirmative, and it passes. Anything else, Mr. Nutt?
No, sir.
Thank you. Tonight we had no one sign up under public comment period, so we'll go to item 7, old business. Render second reading to an uncodified ordinance to grant a utility easement to Broad River Electric to install electrical transformer to serve an expansion at Bottom Arm of Miller Park.
So moved.
I have a motion.
Second.
Any other discussion?
Mr. Chairman, if I may point out to council that you may have noticed that we added the legal description to the ordinance that you have before you tonight. That's a change to the second reading.
Okay. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, a vote affirmative. And let me say, Jim, you know, I was involved in this from day one, and I'm sure that that family is now recognizing the benefit of Bottom Arm of Miller Park. I think it's finally materializing into what, you know, she wanted. So thank you for that.
I have to say this because last week, Mike Nation and I were talking about, you know, the philosophy of bringing the best and greatest value to the citizens of Spartanburg by building out our parks. Our goal is to present something in this next fiscal year that we can say that Bottom Arm Park is complete, and we're not that far away.
In case you don't know the history on this, Justin, Bob, I guess it was about the year 99, and my dad knocks on the door and he says, "Jeff, some kind of lady back here wants to build a park." So she has some land in Florida Springs. I think the county might be interested in this property, so I said, "Sure." So I went back to the back and had a conversation and worked it out with the county that she donated this land to the county. And then that was when 2000, 2001, 2002 came about. I think we spent $600,000 initially. Basically, all that did was grade the property and put a road through the property. So it didn't look like a lot there for a long time for this family. So, you know, she didn't want this to become another subdivision. She wanted this to be something for the community. So I think now, I'm sure you utilize the part that is starting to be a reflection of her desires for the community. So again, thank you, Jim, and your staff for moving this forward. Item B, render second reading to an ordinance to develop. Did I vote on that? Did we get a vote in? Or did I blab right through it? Got it? Okay. Item B, render second reading to an ordinance to develop a jointly owned and operated industrial business park. And render second reading to an ordinance to develop a jointly owned and operated industrial business park project Big Ben in conjunction with Sheriff County.
So moved.
Have a motion. Do we have a second?
Sorry.
Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, a vote affirmative, and it passes. No items under new business. Any other resolutions, ordinances, Casper?
Not
right.
Item 9, under
10,
I do have.
All right. Miscellaneous Council, Administrative Matters, and Budget, VARs, Catherine.
Mr. Chairman, it was brought to my attention during our break that there were two items that were inadvertently left off of the Public Safety Judiciary Committee's agenda. They are both grant requests. Debbie's helping me pass those out to you right now. These are applications for grants. I just wanted to mention them to you and to ask for your assistance. The first is a records improvement grant. It's for $450,000. This is a much-needed improvement to the solicitor's office. The match would be $45,000, and it's my understanding it would come from forfeiture funds. And the second grant request is courtroom technology. The grant is $18,550 with a match of $1,855. Again, that would come from the solicitor's forfeiture funds. And Councilman Brown, if it's okay with you, I'd like to, because of this oversight and the grant deadline, what I'd like to do is to go ahead and submit these grants to the agencies, the granting agencies, and then we'll bring back, if the award is given, we'll bring that back to your committee, Councilman Brown. So no action will be needed by you, but just, I know that you would prefer to have the grant application before we submit it, but because we can't amend the agenda to do that tonight, if it's okay, we'll go ahead and submit it. If the grant is awarded, we'll bring it back to your committee, Councilman Brown.
Fine, everyone.
And then we'll have the solicitor's office explain in more detail what was awarded. Again, this would, because of the solicitor's use of forfeiture funds, there wouldn't be any general funds required for the match. So I'm excited if we receive these grants. That would be great. And I apologize for the oversight and I appreciate your help with that.
All right, motion to approve.
Second.
These would be for the budget amendment resolution.
Yeah, for the BAR. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your hand. All opposed, no more affirmative passes. I would like to say that we are hopeful by our next meeting that we have a new addition to our community and to our county council. Mr. Bradley, I see your bride here today and your mother. Good to have you with us today, and good luck in a couple of weeks, February 14th.
February 14th.
See, she blew my thunder today. If she hadn't been in office, I was going to say, if Justin did both the way I wanted him to go to, I was going to send him nonsense. Your wife's in the delivery room right now, I'm getting bleeding. No, she's sitting there, so I couldn't use that card today. Good to have you, ladies, and good luck.
Thank you.
Okay. I need approval of minutes December 15 and January, December 15 and 14, and January 8 and 15, special meeting. I have a motion to have a second.
Second.
Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, no affirmative.
Michael's a soft caller. Yeah.
Thank you for being here today. Need a motion to adjourn.
Second.